program dedicated to an examination of areas in the human experience not easily nor neatly put in a box. Things seen at the edge of vision, awakening a part of the mind as yet not mapped, and yet things every bit as real as the air we breathe but don't see. This is Dreamland.
This indeed is Sunday evening and Dreamland underway once again. Hi everybody, I'm Art Bell. Great to be here on a Sunday evening. As you know, one of my favorite areas of investigation, without question. A little bit of a difference this evening.
Archives, you're listening to the best of Art Bell. This program originally aired June 5th, 2001. Please do not call.
From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all good evening or good morning or afternoon, wherever you may be across this great land of ours. From in the west, Guam, the island of the rock, eastward to the Caribbean and the U.S. Virgin Islands, south into South America, north all the way to the pole, and worldwide. The old internet. This is Coast to Coast AM, and I'm Art Bell. Glad to be with you. Should be quite a program tonight. Coming up in a moment. Oh my! Some years ago, I interviewed a fellow named Bugs, who claimed that he shot two creatures that he thinks might have been Bigfoot. On my webcam, you will see half of a map. Bugs has sent me a map of the burial location of whatever these creatures are. I don't know that I like that kind of responsibility. We'll ask Bugs here in a minute why he sent it. Robert W. Morgan, who is a premier Bigfoot investigator here in the U.S., and I thought he ought to listen to Bugs' story this time, as we listen to it once again, and maybe he has some questions that I forgot to ask. Pretty serious subject, and why only half a map? Well, that's obvious. First of all, I've got a map to the burial location of two creatures. We'll decide as the program wears on what it is these creatures are. I'm going to introduce two people to you right now. One is Robert W. Morgan. Robert, are you there?
Listening with both ears.
You are there. Okay. Let's see. The first thing you wanted me to do was to give out your phone number on the air, right?
Yeah, just like I'm going to give out your home. You betcha.
All right. So you're kind of in retreat right now. When you first wrote to me, you said I'm kind of undercover with a pal. So you've been nobody's found you for a while, Robert.
Yes, I'm living somewhere in Montana, and as you know, it's a pretty large state.
I know.
And I'm here on purpose, and it's carrying on some things. We've had some rather significant successes with those audio cassettes that I had mentioned to you at one time.
Right.
And so far, 16 people, so far, by following that, have had face-to-face
meetings?
Yes.
Encounters?
Yes.
With Bigfoot?
Yes. And so what I'm trying here is, since I found that I needed an area where I wasn't known and where people would not waste their time playing nonsense, and starting from scratch. And at the same time, of course, I love Montana. I've been in and out of Montana for 20-some years, and it's absolutely fabulous.
All right. So your quest continues, and you've been researching Bigfoot for how long, Robert?
Well, my first sighting was 1957, but I didn't start serious research until about, I think it was 1969.
And you have, did you write a book?
No, I did an audio cassette. The book is incomplete because I haven't finished it yet, for obvious reasons.
All right. Well, I may have another chapter for you here.
Good. I'm all ready.
All right. So you'll be doing a lot of listening, although you're welcome to ask a question as the story unfolds.
Thank you.
It was, I don't even know how long ago. Bugs, are you there?
Yes, I am, Art. Good morning.
Good morning, Bugs. Can you...
Oh, yeah. Bugs
and my dog.
Bugs and a friend. That's your dog, huh?
Yep.
Bugs, you want to tell us what state you're in?
Yeah, I'm in Texas, Art.
Texas. All right. How long ago, Bugs, did you tell me originally the story of what you did?
Gosh, Art, it's been 3 or 4 years.
3 or 4 years. Yeah, I thought it was quite a while. Time flies.
I'm getting older every day.
Aren't we all? All right, Bugs, I've got a real expert here, as you can hear, Robert W. Morgan.
Good morning, Robert.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
Doing fine. You?
I'm fine. I'm alive and meaner than cat dirt.
Well, I keep telling everybody I'm still breathing, so I guess we're all right.
All right, fine. Bugs, if you would, begin at the beginning. And by the way, Bugs, before we even start, why did you send me this map?
Because, Art, my days are limited on this earth, and when I'm gone, my wife's going to call you and say, go for it.
Really?
And you can reveal to the world a map. I have not been back to that place since that day.
All right, let's start then with that day. Go ahead and tell it in as much detail as you want, folks.
Art, me and two of my friends, which I'll refer to as Bird Dog and Jim, were bobcat hunters. Back in the middle 70s, those varmints was worth a lot of money.
How much could you get for one?
Well, no bobcat would bring anywhere from $300 to $700.
Yeah, that's not bad.
And a coyote is bringing like $40-$50 a piece. And then we'd go out, and to be honest with you, it was a little more than a hobby. We were real serious about it.
Right.
And we hunted many, many nights all over this country.
Were you making your living that way then?
Yes, I was. I was farming at that time. I'd gotten out of the Marines and came back home, and I was farming, and in that part of the year, this cotton country up here, so we didn't have much to do in January and February except kind of sit around.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we hunted a lot in that period of time because you had to wait until the freeze come for those pelts to cure. For some reason, I don't know, maybe somebody explain it to me, but an animal like a coon or a coyote or whatever, if you kill them before it comes a hard freeze, when you skin them, their pelts are blue on the inside after they dry out. If you kill them after a hard freeze, they're white.
Huh.
And I have no earthly idea why that is.
Does that sound right to you, Robert?
I've seen that multicoloring, but I had no idea the reason. I didn't make that correlation. That's interesting.
Okay.
So anyway, you know, it was like in December, January, and February that we hunted a tremendous amount. And then in late February, to get into what they call a rutting season, and the animals would get mange and whatever, and they weren't worth hunting. So about 2 months, you had prime time hunting. And me and these two guys, we hunted a lot. We were all three from Vietnam veterans and very close friends. And one night, we had gone, I don't know how to tell this to keep from giving the location away. But
whatever words you want doesn't matter.
If somebody knows what I'm talking about, they can find out. But anyway, we had hunted, and we back in the flatlands, so then we took this road back up north of where I'm at now, and it swung around. It runs through ranch country. It's probably 25-30 miles of ranch land.
So in other words, this location is within, 100 miles of where you are now?
Oh, it's closer than that.
Closer than that, all right.
Within 30 miles of where I'm at right now.
Okay.
So anyway, we came around and we came across this, we were going to cross this creek. It's more than a creek, its name is Elm Creek. And we were going to cross that creek. We'd come around back north and coming down that county road through this ranch land and stuff. And these ranchers loved us because we'd get rid of the coyotes that were taking their calves. And this had to be probably three, four, five in the morning. I don't remember the exact time.
Mm-hmm.
Come around the bend, and then in this bottom there, just before you cross Elm Creek.
So you're hunting with lights then?
Oh, yeah. We're using spotlights. off the top, off the roof of the pickup, using 500 watt halogen bulbs. It would light up anything from within a half a mile. You can see where you're standing, see the ground good.
And anything with eyes lights up real well.
Them eyes. The thing about it is, after you hunted as much as we did, you could tell by looking at a set of eyes what they were.
Mm-hmm.
If they were a cow, they were wide apart and they were red. If they were a coyote, they were narrow and they were more blue-red. I mean, it just, after a period of time, Art, you knew what, you could look in that scope and you knew what was there.
I'm not a hunter, so I just take your word for it.
Well, it was just out of way. I mean, but anyway, we come around this bend and come up over this rise, and there was a wheat field out in front of us, and just before we crossed this creek, and it was a valley down there, and it's probably, has wheat land right there, and it's probably a quarter mile or so wide to from that road to the creek, and it's probably about a mile long, runs alongside that creek, and it's flat and has that. And we come around this bend and up and over a little hill and dropped into this valley. Well, just as we dropped into this valley, our lights hit, picked up a set of eyes. And I hit the brakes. I was driving, and Bird Dog, he come out on the side. He had a 300 Weatherby Magnum, and he come across the top. I said, "What you got?" And he says, "I don't know. That ain't something I ever seen before." Well, it just sat there. And so I put
When you said a set of eyes, did you mean two eyes or four?
Two eyes.
What color were they, Bugs, if you don't mind?
They were furious red. The reddest eyes I've ever seen in my life.
Really?
Under those lights. It was something we knew it wasn't a deer because of the eyes, and it was something. And so I pulled my rifle out. I used a 243. I put my scope on it. And I could see whatever it was is crouching. And so Bird Dog, he got out and leaned over the hood of the pickup where he could get him a good shot. And Jim, he come up over the top of the cab, and I don't even remember what kind of, I think he was using the 270, I don't remember for sure. But he lined up over the cab, and I was sitting there, and we just had both these spotlights on this varmint there. And I said, "I don't know what it is," and they don't either. And I said, "Well, it sure isn't nothing we know about it. Let's take it." And all three of us fired at the same time. And all of a sudden, this thing got up, and it must have been 7-8 foot tall at least. I don't know. Scared the heck out of us. Started running. And well, we all loaded, and we fired again. We knocked it down again. And then it run, I guess, it was probably 150 yards from the point we fired the first time till it hit the fence and went into that creek. And we knocked it down. It's probably 25, 30 yards from the fence.
It fell into a creek.
No, not at this point. And just as it was crossing the creek, we hit it again.
Now, was it running on four legs or two?
It was running on two legs, just like a human being. You know, sure. I mean, it was...
Right, so it was running on two legs. It's
right.
Something you've never seen before, but you three guys cut down on it.
Well, we had done shot, and we did not know what it was. It was hunched over. It really wasn't using its front legs, I mean, its arms, as much as it was. It wasn't standing up straight. We still thought it was, what I thought it was at first, to be honest with you, was a bear.
Yeah.
And that's why we fired.
All right, so you had three of you fired initially, right?
And
so
we all fired three times.
So
you guys are all non-vets, right?
Right.
And so you've had night combat, I'm sure.
Right.
Okay, so you have something getting up on two legs and running away, and you still cut down on it. Okay, I have the picture. Go ahead, please.
Okay. Well, like I said, I originally thought it was a bear. I did not even, I had no idea. We had done fired on it at the point in time that it was sitting out there. And once we fired, I don't know, I guess we just got a little bit gung-ho and kept shooting. But anyway, the second time we shot it, went over the fence. Well, we went and looked, and we, at this point in time, we were all getting scared because we thought, well, maybe this wasn't an animal.
Right.
So, like I say, it was probably 3, 4, 5 in the morning, so we decided to drive around a while, about 5:36. We went back over there, and we drove up there, and we went down, and we seen blood. So we've seen some tracks. Looked like a human foot. And to be honest with you, I thought, well, now we done shot a human.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm getting scared. So we go on up and start following these tracks, and the creek runs all from this point probably 50, 75 yards east, and then it turns back south some. Well, these tracks are going down the creek, and they come out, and they went straight on east from where the creek turned back south. About another 25, 30 yards, there was a plum thicket. And we were walking there, and we heard something in that plum thicket. I mean, it was a growl type sound. And we kind of looked at each other, and so we decided, well, who goes in and see what it was?
A growl.
Yeah, and again, at this point, we thought, well, it's a bear. We done found a bear up here. So I got elected. I had a .44 Magnum pistol. I climbed into the plum thickets, and I got in, oh, probably 20 feet at the most. And Art, this thing come up at me. I mean, it couldn't have been over, I'd say, 6 or 7 feet from me. I didn't even see it until it was there. And it raised up and let out a sound that is very similar to the one you have on your tape. And when it did...
You're talking about as he grabs for it, this one, I presume. Anything like that?
Yeah, just the first one, not a repeat.
That first scream is said to be an authentic Bigfoot sound, Robert.
Yeah, that's what they say. I have never heard them scream like that. I've heard them howl, I've heard them hoot, and I've heard them talk. But
never heard a scream like that?
No. First of all, I've never challenged them, so they don't perceive me as a threat of any sort, so they wouldn't try to...
Understood. All right, so anyway, Bugs, it sounded something like that.
There's something similar to just the first part. It didn't go on and on. It's just one shrill.
Right.
And I'm basically on my all fours in a crawl position, and I just brought my .44 up, and I started popping shells. And the first one I hit... the first one hit it, I just aiming right at the chest.
Describe what this thing, since you were seeing it now full on, what did it look like? Best you can.
At that point.
6 feet tall.
Probably, but it was not standing up, Art, at that point. It was more in a hunched, squat-type position.
All right.
I mean, it come up.
Would you describe this as human-looking, as ape-looking? Did it have hair covering it? What can you tell us about it?
It had brownish-red hair. It had hair on the face, completely covering the face. Its whole body was covered with hair. At that point, I just fired. It dropped down, started back up, I fired again. And it then kind of rocked and went backwards, and it come back up, and I fired again. I hit it 3 times with 225 grain, .44 Magnum hollow point, probably 6 to 8 feet. And it was down. Well, the other guys were standing guard up on top watching, and they couldn't see nothing. They heard me firing, and they yelled. He says, all right, and I said, yeah, I got it. Well, they came crawling in there and where I was at, and they seen it, so we decided we'd drag it out. We got to looking, and all this thing had was three holes. And this was a female. You could tell it had breasts similar to a woman. It had a sexual organ and similar to a woman.
Really?
Facial features were different than a human being. Like I say, it was covered completely in hair. So we went back in and we found the male probably, I'd say, 8-10 foot behind where she was at. He was dead.
He was dead?
Yeah. So we drug him out. We laid him out side by side. The male was probably 6 to 8 inches taller than the female, estimating the male to probably be 8 foot plus, female 7 plus. So we looked at him, we got scared because, like I said, in the male, he had sexual organs like a human. We looked at their teeth, they were not human type teeth. I can't say that they were an ape. I can't say that they were a human. They looked, they had the features of a human overall, but the details were not.
Okay. Bugs, I want you to hold on. We'll be back to you shortly. We're coming toward a break. And Robert W. Morgan, hold on. Okay, so what do you think Bugs had just shot? Two creatures. We'll get more of a description. We'll get more of a story in a moment. Robert W. Morgan, Bigfoot researcher, and Bugs, whose real name, by the way, I have, along with a map to the location of the bodies of whatever it is you just heard was shot. This is Coast to Coast to Coast AM.
Special replay of Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. This program originally aired June 5th, 2001. Please do not call. Wanna take a ride? Well, call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. The wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. And to reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Networks.
That would be us. Morning, everybody. I have two guests, Bugs, who shot a couple of creatures, and Robert W. Morgan, a Bigfoot researcher. And we'll get back to them in a moment and the rest of Bugs' story. And I'm getting a lot of interesting fast blasts about this, a lot of them very judgmental. We'll talk about that in a moment. Once again, I want to cover this. I'm getting a lot of judgmental stuff, saying stuff like, you killed it after you knew it was a bear or thought it was a bear? Or did it ever occur to him that maybe he shouldn't shoot it, or at least he had to run the other way? Or, my God, out shooting animals? You know, a lot of judgmental stuff. But if I were to be judgmental, we wouldn't get the story. What I really want is the truth here. So I'm not going to sit in judgment of of bugs. There are a lot of people responding that way, Bugs, as you might imagine. I'm not interested so much in that as I am the truth. I want the truth, and if the truth is what you were doing, then that's what you were doing. And so I just want the truth, and you are telling us the truth, right?
That is correct, R. I wouldn't have sent you my mail otherwise.
No, I believe you. I believed you the first time, and I believe you now. There are a lot of people who don't like it, but this is a very important story in view of the probable physical evidence that still exists.
You've got to remember something. At that point in time, we were making our living basically hunting. Art, there was many a night that I went out and I made $1,000 in a night.
Really?
I mean, there was one night, my biggest night ever. We killed 3 bobcats, 7 coyotes, and 18 coons, and we had $2,400 the next day.
I've got you. I'm not judging you here. Somebody else would like to know. They've got a 5-year-old listening, and they want to know really what these creatures look like. Now, you said not exactly human, not exactly total animal, like something in between. Is there any way you can describe the facial features of these creatures? It should be imprinted on your memory.
Yeah, Art. No, because I've never seen nothing on this earth that looks like them. Their heads, they have a nose similar to a human.
Okay.
Their mouths appear to be more ape. Their eyes are sunken back in their head more than human. Okay. I mean, I think if you take a human and cross it with a ape, you could probably come up with a reasonable facsimile of it.
Oh. You know what I might suggest, Art, if you don't mind?
Sure.
Bugs, after we go off the air, if you would give Art your mailing address, which
Art has my mailing address,
I have it.
He has my phone number, he has everything.
What I'd like to do is...
Robert, let me just interrupt. I've promised him anonymity, and we'll explain why here shortly.
Oh, no. What I mean is, what I'd do is send a copy to you, Art, and have you forward to Bugs. The idea is this. Now, on the cover of that is one of the best artist renderings I have ever seen, because I sat with the artist myself.
On the cover of what?
On the cover of the cassette. That I have.
Of a cassette? Oh, of your cassette, all right.
Right. And that way, what I'd like to do is get a reaction from Bugs and he can tell that to you. That's number one. Number two, can I ask you something, Bugs? What
sure.
kind of soil were these two buried in? Was it sandy? Was it dirt?
This part of the country is sandy loam, and it was, it wasn't, silk sand, but it was a sandy loam in that particular place where we buried them. It was more of a gravel type sand, because it was did have some rock in it, because that creek was probably, from the point we buried them, the creek kind of went south about probably 150, 200 yards, and then it turned back east, and over the period of time when we had a lot of high rains in this part of the country, it would wash silt and such in there.
Are you saying that the creek would overflow into this specific area?
Yes.
Oh, boy. Because that'll cause a different type of decomposition. Did you take a GPS reading?
A what?
Probably not, Robert. I would say not. A GPS.
Oh, no. I don't have one of them animals.
Yeah.
Okay. If we supplied one, would you take the readings and send those to Art?
He's given me an extremely specific map.
Oh, okay.
Very, very specific.
I mean, that map is detailed down.
Yeah.
To the foot.
You would know where to dig. Listen.
To be honest with you, this happened 30-plus years ago, and I have not been out there since.
Bugs, when you had these things lying on the ground, what did you guys talk about, and why did you decide to bury them?
We thought there could be human art. and we didn't want to go to jail.
But what you just described is, I understand. In other words, there were enough
human...
you're
sitting there and you're looking at the sexual organs of two animals that's got identical to human beings, what do you think?
Robert, with what you know about Bigfoot, do they have sexual organs, the reports you get, do they have sexual organs similar to humans?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
They do.
So far, everything that Bugs has mentioned is something that I've observed myself, so yes.
Oh.
He's right on the nose.
Thank you, Robert. I appreciate that fact.
Have you ever seen, Bugs, any of the Bigfoot photos, like the Patterson film,
any of those that exist?
You haven't?
No.
Would somebody please send me a good Bigfoot photograph right away?
I'm on a computer. I can't look at it.
Well, it's too bad our website isn't up because we have all of them on there.
Oh, you do?
Yes, and unfortunately it's under a reconstruction right at the moment.
Okay, well, somebody will send us a photograph, depend on that. In the next 15 minutes or so, we'll try and get it up for the next hour.
I will give a little more detail as to the location of this to tease the people out there.
All right.
The biggest river in the state of Texas that I guess you might say is the Red River. This Elm Creek is a branch off of the Red River of the state of Texas.
Okay. That's the only sound. Actually, you heard that scream sound, but other than that, you heard a growling. What you would describe as
Art, I don't know whether it was a growling or a rustling or something, but something got our attention in those bushes.
Now, when they moved, you said they moved on 2 feet, or seemed to walk on 2 feet, hunched over or straight up?
It was hunched over. To be honest with you, when it was running, it looked like a bear. When it was running away from us, it looked like a bear, and I'm thinking dollar signs. That's why I fired.
He was probably pretty badly injured by your first fusillade. And what he was doing, I think, is, number one, escaping. Number two, he was going to the protection, hopefully, of his mate. And the mate may have picked him up and carried him to where you caught him.
I don't know that happened. It's possible because there was grass where he came out of that creek and headed east there.
Mm-hmm. Maurice in Modesto, California asks, if you were hunting for money, why didn't you all decide to bring these creatures back for a hell of a profit? They'd be worth a fortune.
Yeah, and maybe go to jail for the rest of your life, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think the fellow in Modesto is overlooking the fact that if these are humanoids, then under the American Constitution, they have civil rights. And Bugs is indeed correct. He could be charged with manslaughter, at least.
You know what? By the time we did the original show, by the time we finished the original show, Bugs was actually going to invite me out there, and we were going to dig these bodies up.
Good.
This was years ago.
I said I'd show you, Art. I ain't digging them up. Let me tell you something. I own a farm near this place.
Yes, sir.
And Art, I won't go out there at night because about a year or so ago, I was out there late one evening with my dogs. They love to go out and swim in the creek. And I heard that sound. And Art, I know they still want out there. And to be honest with you, I think they're looking for me.
Well, I'll tell you what, Bugs, we could do something. This is just a proposition here. If you would show Art where it is, and if I could be somehow involved, I would take the heat for you. I think I could get you off the hook on that.
I'm not sure you could take the heat. In fact, Larry in Anchorage asks, is it even feasible to believe these bodies are still there?
It's pretty rough in that kind of sandy loam because if you have a lot of water running through there, they're going to decompose rather rapidly, and this would also escaping gases would call in coyotes, and those skeletons.
Well, now we buried them probably. They had to be at least 4 or 5 foot deep, Robert.
Oh, really?
And let me tell you something. Like our training, we were all Vietnam vets. We know how to cover our tracks. To be honest with you, when we walked away from there, you couldn't tell there was a hole dug there.
Yeah, is that right? It's too bad you didn't have a couple of body bags, huh? That would have helped. Because the idea is, since the Art, you know my feeling about hunting and using guns on Bigfoot. However, if the deed is done, there's nothing we can do, but we wouldn't want them to die in vain. And if they can prove, Bugs, listen to me, please. If we can prove that they exist by virtue of two skeletons, then in effect you are protecting the rest of them, because I'm very confident they're going to come out as a humanoid. So an act on your part at this point in time would indeed help protect the rest of them.
Bugs, what about your two friends? What has their attitude been since?
You know something, we haven't talked in probably, I guess, 10 or 15 years. They both moved away from here. I think they both had kind of the same feeling I did. It was time to pack up and go.
You might have killed something, a human or something human.
I mean, it wasn't that it bothered us that we killed humans, because we had done that before. You know, I mean, to take out a person, that was no big deal to us.
But that was in war, and they
That's
were
right.
armed.
Right.
That's
right.
A totally different thing.
Totally different situation what we were in there today. At that time.
Yeah, you were doing your duty, pal.
I know. I understand that. But then, you know, when we got into this situation, I would have not have shot the female once I saw her, except I feared for my own life.
Sure. Oh, you had right to there.
Bugs.
She would have attacked you.
Bugs, what about smell? Did you smell anything? Did these creatures smell?
Art, I can't remember. I really can't remember that.
If it had been really distinct, I'm sure you would have.
Yeah, it would probably have. Yeah, I tried to block a lot of this out of my memory. And it's tough trying to draw it back up, because I knew what I'd done, I realized what we'd done, and I realized that, you know, there might be consequences. And the only reason I sent you this map and everything is because for 3 years, I have never had one phone call. You knew who I was, you knew where I was, you knew my phone number and everything, yet nobody ever got it. So I trust you.
And you can trust me, although I'm not sure I'm happy I have the map. If you dug the hole 4 to 5 feet deep, shot them at 4 a.m, drove around, shot more, they would have been digging and burying in the daylight, correct?
Right. This was, the sun come up probably, I'd say around 6 o'clock, 6:30. It was daylight. The sun wasn't up, but it was daylight enough for us to see. And when we found them, we're probably talking about the sun was just ready to peek over the top of the hill. We're talking probably 6:30, 6:45, maybe 7 o'clock. And after we found them and drug them out and everything, we're talking probably 8 o'clock. And it don't take very long to dig when you're scared. And probably within an hour, we had dug the hole and put them back.
Huh.
In it, and we'd left.
Did you bury them in one hole or separate holes?
One.
One hole.
On top of each other.
Yeah, that would make sense. After this was over and they were buried, did the three of you talk?
Yeah.
And what'd you
talk? We swore ourselves to secrecy, Art.
You swore each other to secrecy?
Yeah. Never reveal it to anybody.
Except for years later, many years later, you went on the radio with me and you told this story.
Well,
and now you're telling
you know,
it again.
When you get to be old, I guess you start thinking about some things you did in your life that I need to make some corrections about.
That you weren't that happy about, huh?
No. That was one of the few things that I did in my life that I'm still scared about today, Art.
You feel guilty about it?
Oh, yeah. Tremendous amount of guilt. Because I don't know, I might have took an innocent human being's life.
You know, maybe for a hunter it's not the same way, Bugs, but when you look into a human's eye, you can see an intelligence. I mean, you know you're dealing with an intelligent creature. And I don't know if you had enough eye contact before, or it all happened too fast in all probability, but I wonder if you had a chance to look into their eyes and whether you discerned anything from that, whether you were dealing with an intelligence or something that was about to kill you.
No, Art, I, to be honest with you, it was just a quick knee-jerk reaction, and it was fire, because I knew that I was in danger, and I knew she was fixing to come after me. And I knew it was a matter of a millisecond. I either had to fire or I was gone, and I didn't hesitate.
Yeah, obviously, with the other one dead, I would think that that creature would have killed you pretty quick, if it could have.
Yes, it would.
Oh, Art, it could have. Believe you me, as big as this thing was. Art, I'm 6'1".
There's a lot of Bugs, there's a lot of people that think that Bigfoot is some sort of paranormal creature. But it sounds to me like the creatures were real dead. You know, like animals and mammals and humans who get shot are dead.
Yep.
Nothing paranormal about that.
No,
this
was an animal.
They never disappeared on you.
Nope.
Or nothing ever strange.
Nope.
What about blood?
Red blood, just like ours.
A lot of it?
Quite a bit. Especially hers. I mean, his. He had a big pool where he was hit, and near the heart area, I would assume. I imagine the pool of blood, I'm trying to remember now, but I would say it was probably where he was laying, and he bled probably a foot and a half circle diameter.
So everybody swore everybody else to secrecy forever on this matter. Robert, if it happened that long ago, and assuming that the remains have not been washed away, what might we expect to find, if anything?
You could find quite a bit of the skeleton. Most importantly for us, I think it would be finding the teeth, because within the teeth, even after many years, you can find viable DNA.
DNA?
Yes.
All right, well, I've heard that they found hair recently, and they do a DNA test on it, and it comes back as hominoid of some sort, unidentifiable. So what do we get from that? In other words, if you have a hair sample and they say, well, yes, it was some sort of mammal or hominoid in some way, but it was it's not identifiable, and that's the end of the story.
Right. That happened to us. We had that in 1974, and we had that also in 1972. Hair tells you quite a bit about the DNA, but it still will not convince science. Now, if we can get a complete skeleton, especially if we have two, male and female, if there's sufficient bones there, they can be reconstructed, and they can provide the proof that the Bigfoot, A, does exist, B, well, whether or not they are humanoid or whether they're pongidae, or otherwise, if they're human or alien.
Robert, do you believe Bugs?
Everything that I have heard Bugs say has what I would call the ring of truth.
We'll be right back.
This is a special replay of Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell. This program originally aired June 5th, 2001. Please do not call. Want to take a ride? Call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. The wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. And to call Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
I think Bugs is exactly who he sounds like he is. I thought that the first time I interviewed him, the second time, and now, same deal, folks. I think he is exactly who he appears to be. And I think the story is absolutely true. My guests include Robert W. Morgan, a Bigfoot researcher, and Bugs, who killed two creatures in the wilds of Texas. And it may well be they are Bigfoot. Or Bigfoots. I still haven't quite figured that out. At any rate, my guests will be back in a moment. And within about 10 minutes, we're going to have some photos up on the website, some real quick ones for Bugs to take a look at. I'm Art Bell. Have Bugs here for a little while longer, so on top of him seeing the photographs, I want to ask him a few more questions with Robert before we lose him. I know you had a really hard day today, didn't you, Bugs?
Yeah. I've got a couple questions I need to ask Robert.
All right.
Robert, can these creatures know who I am and what I did?
Yes. Yes.
The reason why I say that is because, like I said, it's been 6 months. It was last summer. I was at my farm late one evening, and it just got dark. And I have a creek that runs into this creek that I'm talking about. And I heard it was not a coyote type howl. Mm-hmm. And it just made the hair on my back of my neck stand up, and I just felt in my heart that this had to be one of these creatures.
Was it the same kind of howl, or roughly the same?
As what?
As what you heard originally?
No. This was not similar to what you have on tape. This
No. To what you heard originally.
Well, I don't know, Art.
That's right.
I don't know. I can't place...
How many statute miles are you from the site?
Well, that creek's approximately 6 miles.
About 6 miles away?
Yeah.
And, now this is going to sound like a strange question. Does the water flow upstream or downstream from where you are?
Downstream. It flows down into this place.
And had you hunted that area before?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So the identification, they could have identified you. And believe me, 6 miles is a Sunday stroll for these people. So more than likely, they have identified you. Yes, you're probably right.
I would be very careful. Am I in any danger?
It's been how many years?
This is 1976.
Right, 76. It's possible, but I would say that, I'm going to sound very, very weird here for a second. If you would go out on the edge of that and hold your hands open and open to your side where they can see you have no weapon whatsoever, and now this is going to sound strange to you, talk to them. Just talk, and whenever you have a feeling they're out there, go out and just let yourself go. Tell them what you think and what you made a mistake. It doesn't hurt anyone. It could help you, and God only knows they might understand. I don't know.
Well,
I certainly would try it.
I don't even own a weapon anymore. After this happened, I quit hunting. I couldn't even pull a trigger. Now, even probably to defend myself.
Bugs, I have a question for you. Chris in Medford, Oregon asks, I was wondering how heavy these creatures were, and he thinks you can judge this because you all had to lift them to bury them, right?
Right. I'm going to say they probably weighed 350 pounds.
Oh, my.
In that area.
Oh, my.
It was all we could do to move them.
That's a lot of body mass.
Oh, that, tell me about it. Dead body is the heaviest thing on earth.
Somebody else says, and you, maybe this isn't true, or maybe it certainly is, the only thing missing is the grief that he hides, that he has nightmares of killing the female.
Yeah, I did for a long time, Art. Did for a long time. I have woke up at night, again in that position, firing my weapon. I mean, I went through some hairy things in Vietnam. I was with the 1st Marine Recon in Vietnam.
Good Lord.
I did a lot of LARPs, 21 days, 12 days. I know what it's all about. That don't bother me. This thing with her bothers me worst of all of them, because that's the closest I've ever come to death.
Yeah, I hear you. You described the fact that the imprint of the feet seemed like a human footprint.
Yeah.
Was it bigger than a usual human footprint? But judging by the weight, I would think it would be.
Oh, yes. I would say, oh, isn't it Michael Jordan and has to have a size 18 shoes or what basketball player? I would say it's probably in that size. There is one thing that I've never revealed to anybody about the foot of this animal.
What?
And that's why I'm very reluctant. A lot of these people talk about Bigfoot and stuff, but there is something about their feet that is different than anybody else. Robert should know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I think I do.
Well, let's not have Robert say. You say.
Yeah.
What?
Six toes.
Oh.
What?
Six toes.
Six toes on both of the creatures, both feet?
Both of the creatures.
That's an anomaly, I think. I think that's an anomaly. But I'm going to take a wild guess here. You must be within 100 miles of the Arkansas border.
No.
And the reason I say, well, in that case, there was a family in Arkansas of Bigfoot that did have a six-toed genetic code.
Okay.
And they may have spread into eastern Texas. That is possible, but that is not the norm.
All right.
Okay. I am in the Texas Panhandle, and this creek.
Don't say anymore, Bugs. Don't say anymore.
Yeah, don't say anymore.
The Texas Panhandle is close enough.
And everything, you know. Red River runs from Arkansas up to Texas. Mm-hmm. It's the border of Texas, Oklahoma. So I'm assuming that these animals come from that direction. Where they were going, I have no idea.
Bugs, you said that in the light, the eyes were red. What about...
Spotlights, yes.
Yeah, what about when they were dead? Did you get to see...
Black.
Black.
I couldn't see any pupils or anything like that, and just black eyes. A little larger than human eyes.
Okay.
You know, Bugs, I'm very sorry. I'm not a hunter myself. I used to hunt years and years ago, but I came through the same transition that you did. I don't want to see anything die anymore. I have no time for it. But at the same time, I must say, honestly, I'm so pleased that you contacted Art Bell.
Bugs, if you said you had a computer there.
Yes.
Go right now to your. Is it?
Really? I'm gonna have your website up.
Oh, you do.
Yeah.
Under What's New, you'll see the first item now instead of cloud vortex is Bigfoot images. Click on that.
No, all I've got. Let me refresh.
Refresh, and then go to What's New, and you'll see Bigfoot images.
Okay.
You see them?
They're coming up.
Okay. There's four of them there right now. My listener is doing me a favor in getting these images up quickly. Some are drawings.
I think everybody else hit the website at the same time as me.
Two of them are, looks like at least one is a photograph. Two may be photographs and two are drawings.
This first one coming up, the hair is the wrong color.
Okay. But what about the general... Was it closer to a human than that?
Oh yeah, this looks like an ape here.
Yeah.
This first picture, of course, like I say, it's loading up slow. All I've seen now is the eyes, but the eyes were sunken in. But the above the eyes, I guess you'd call the eyebrow area, it was flatter than that.
Okay.
The nose was totally different. The nose was more human.
Okay.
The mouth is very, very similar.
Okay, what about you, Robert? Do you have internet access where you are?
No, I'm on the line that I usually use. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to send a copy of the drawing down to you, Art, and
okay.
You can forward it to Bugs.
I can do that. Just give it a few minutes, Bugs, and the rest of these will
load. Okay, the third picture, Art, looks just about like it.
Oh, really? The third one down?
Yeah.
All right.
Very, very close.
This appears to be an actual photograph. To be honest with you, it's a photograph, and it may be a photograph taken from the Patterson film. I'm not sure.
The third one doesn't look like that. Second one. I mean, it's almost a dead ringer.
Oh, you're saying
the third one.
The
fourth picture does not look like it, but the third picture is almost a dead ringer.
Number three is in an oval.
Yeah.
And it's almost a dead ringer for it.
Yeah, almost identical.
Boy, I wish you had internet access, Robert.
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm talking on the line.
I'll tell you what, Robert.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't I do this? If I were to drop you off the line for a few minutes.
Okay.
Could you get to my internet site?
I can certainly try.
Okay, remember now, you'll be able to get on, no problem. www.artbell.com.
Right.
It'll be under What's New, which is the first item on the left when you load the website. It'll say, it will say Bigfoot images. And because we've got a hit here, because he says it's like number three.
Okay.
If you would go down and take a look at number three, I will call you back in about 8 minutes.
Okay, I'll get on it right now.
All right. Let me see if I can do this properly. Okay, let's see. And I think that I've done it. Let me see if I can bring back Bugs. Bugs, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, good. All right, Bugs, so number three is pretty close, huh? That's
very, very close, Art. The only thing about number three that I can see the difference between it and what my recollection is the eyebrow area was a little less protruding.
Otherwise, the head?
The head,
the mouth?
The mouth is identical. The nose is identical.
Wow.
And what picture? Is this an actual picture?
I believe, and I'm not certain, but I believe, and now Robert will be able to tell us, he's the expert on this, but I think this might be from the Patterson film. I'm not sure.
Okay.
All right. This was sent in just by a listener, but it doesn't matter. Obviously, I would say it's a real photograph that we're looking at. And judging from this, now, was there any... Other than the sex organs, was there any discernible difference between the male and the female?
That was it, Art. The male was a little taller, like I say, probably 6-8 inches taller, and probably weighed, I'd say 30, maybe 30 pounds more, maybe 40-something in that neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
They were both extremely muscular. They didn't appear to have any what I would call human-type fat on them. And their abdomen area, the mid-age bulge, or whatever you want to call it, they appeared to be just very, very muscular type people. I wanted to say people, but animals. I still kind of feel like they're people, Art.
Really?
Yep.
You, in sending me the map, Bugs, you said that you're not going to be around forever. Well, I'm not going to be around forever either. And I don't know what to do with this. I don't know what's right to do with it. I don't know if it would result in both of us getting in trouble, even today. I'm not sure. Maybe,
Well, if you feel the If you don't need to have it, then burn it. I have a copy. My wife has a copy. She has the original. And everything we faxed to you.
And what did you tell her about this? When you gave her copy of the map, what did you tell her?
She was in shock and awe when I first revealed this because she knew nothing about it, and we'd been married for years. She knew nothing about it until the night I talked to you on the radio.
Oh. Then you all must have had a pretty big talk about it afterwards, huh?
Oh, yeah. She wanted to go see the place, and I said, we ain't going over there. There is no way I will go back to where that area is.
Why?
I don't know, Art. Something scares me about it.
Did you end up with any of the creature's blood on your clothing, shoes, whatever?
Not that I'm aware of, Art.
Because blood, too, has DNA in it.
I know. It's possible in moving them and everything that we did, but it wasn't something we noticed. And my wife wouldn't have said anything because, you know, we handle coats and bobcats and stuff like that. We got blood on.
Okay, Mike.
On them out.
Yeah, I hear you. Mike in San Angelo, Texas, down there in Texas with the asks. The hands, the feet, would you describe them as leathery? Were the nails thick? Were the ears big? Was anything weird about the teeth? Did you think you were looking at a meat eater or a vegetarian? Any guesses?
I would say, just offhand, probably a vegetarian. But then again, Art, I don't know. You know,
sure.
We're talking about a total time of me looking at these animals and burying them.
About how long?
Time, an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours.
As you guys tried to figure out what to do, huh?
Oh, yeah. Well, we knew what to do. We went and got the shovels and started digging.
Yeah. What about the hands and feet? He's asking, were they leathery feeling? Can you remember any texture? Can you remember anything about it?
Art, I can't remember other than their hands. I don't know how to describe them. It would be like somebody that had a pair of cowhide gloves on. With hair around them, and in their palm area, just skin type showing, kind of, I guess you would say a leathery type hands. And their feet, bottom of their feet were the same way. The only thing, like I say, the hands and the bottom of their feet were probably the only thing it wasn't covered with hair. And it wasn't completely covered with hair, but then again,
pretty close to how much hair there was there on number three?
Yeah, very similar, very similar.
Since that's happened, since you've been on my show, the original time you appeared on my program, have you told anybody else about this?
Yeah, there's one other person in this world knows about it because he had an encounter here a while back with one. He decided he was going to follow his uncle and be a great white hunter. Till one night he come across one about, I guess it's been a month and a half, 2 months ago. I'd say 40 miles from where this happened. And he come home telling me about it about 3 days later. He was scared. And then I told him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, that's exactly what I saw. And I said, well, why didn't you shoot it? He said, man, I didn't know what it was. I said, I got the hell out of there, pardon my French.
You know, I imagine when you think back on your encounter, you probably wish you'd done that too. But by the time you'd shot the thing initially, so many shots, I guess you pursue it. You don't leave an animal out to die.
No, you're right. If it's wounded, you want to put it out of its misery. And again, Art, we thought it was a bear. Just to be perfectly honest with you, I mean.
Yeah, even up until the moment that you shot the final creature dead, you still really thought it was a bear, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I thought it was a wounded bear in the bushes, and that's what we're laughing about. Who's going into the thicket to get the bear?
How'd you get elected?
I was the only one. I had the most high-powered pistol. Bird Dog, he had a .357, and Jim, he had a .22. And I had a .44 Magnum Ruger. And so they said, well, you got the big gun. You go in.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, I want it to go.
By the way, I can hear something creaking, and I imagine that's your easy chair you're rocking back in, if I had to guess.
Right, it is.
All right, Bugs, hold on. We won't hold you too much longer. Just a couple more questions. We'll get Robert W. back on with us in a moment. A lot of people say that's what Bugs could do. Make millions now. I just sense truth about this story, and I don't know why. I always have, since I first heard it, I've sensed it was a truth, and I think that now. Anyway, for those of you checking it out, it's number three, the third photograph.
Of Art Bell. This program originally aired June 5th, 2001. Please do not call. Want to take a ride? Call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First time callers may reach Art at area code 775-727-1222 or call the wildcard line at 775-727-1295. To talk with Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It certainly is. My guests are Robert W. Morgan, who is now back after having seen the photograph himself, and Bugs, who will remain identified as far as location beyond that which he's already given, and certainly not his real name. At his request, I will keep it secret forever if necessary. And I guess that's what we're going to talk about in a moment. Robert W. Morgan back, and Bugs, and we're not going to have Bugs for much longer, so just a couple more questions, Bugs, and any Robert might have. You've given me a very detailed map, but Todd in Lakeside wants to know, could you actually walk to the spot where you buried them, no problem?
Yeah, I believe I could.
But you wouldn't?
No, I don't want to go back out there, Art.
Not even with myself and or Robert Morgan?
I'll get you close, but I ain't going back out there.
All right. Two questions from Ian in Charleston, South Carolina. How many times did you have to shoot the creature? A question I think you already answered. And
I think we fired three times at the first one, and I know I fired three times at the female.
Did it emit any kind of sound while the other one was shot? Was there any reaction? Or was it too hard to see?
We did not see the female until...
Oh, that's right.
I went into the thicket.
Okay. I'm told that you should one more time refresh your computer screen because there are now a total of six images up there. Too bad for you, Robert. Anyway, listen, Robert, you got to see the third one down, which he says is pretty doggone close to what he saw.
Yeah, that's a good one. There's nothing wrong with that.
You think that one's fairly representative of what a Bigfoot would look like?
Yes. It very much, it's very, very close. Very close.
All right, Robert, do you have anything?
If you would take the hair on number four and darken it a bit,
that'd be close.
Put it on, that would be the color of the hair. It's a little too red. It's more brown than it is than that red.
All right.
I'll give you a little hint on that. The younger ones have the reddish hair. The older they get, the darker they get. And then when they get into old age, of course, they become grizzled, just like us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Neither of these two.
So
the fifth picture, it's hard to tell. I can't see facial features or anything. Mm-hmm. In the sixth picture, doesn't even look like nothing like what
okay.
I saw.
So it's number three all the way.
Yeah, it's got number three. Number three is almost identical.
All right, good. Good.
Well,
Bugs, I'm going to send you one by way of art that I think you're going to say, oh, my God, that's him.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, Robert, last chance. Any other questions for Bugs?
No other questions except that I will provide through you, Art, and if anything I can do to assist either of you or both of you, I'd be more than happy to. Sorry that it happened.
He's obviously not going back there.
Well, I believe me, Bugs, I it's hard to say, but if I went along, I think you'd be fairly safe.
I wonder if we don't identify Bugs, Robert, and we were to go there, or you were to go there, what our liability would be?
None. There would be no problem whatsoever.
But the problem is everybody in this part of the world knows who I am.
Well, we needn't divulge where we got them. Simple as that.
Have you, I guess you've thought over the years you'd face maybe jail time for this, huh?
Right.
You would never be convicted of first degree anything because there wasn't. But
yeah, but I'm 56 years old, Art, now.
We're the same age. I'll be 56 June 17th, so.
Yes, but you know, what you did, though, was not, you did not know it was a Bigfoot. You did not fire on it as a Bigfoot. I don't see, if you had known what it was and you fired, that's one thing. The first one that you fired on was at such a distance, and it was an irrational, or not an irrational, irresponsible act, but it's done. What's done is done. Secondly, you did the other one in self-defense, and I doubt that anyone is going to blame you for that. I'm sorry that it happened simultaneously, but I think the furtherance for science and also the furtherance for the protection of the children of these two adults that are dead, they could benefit by the protection that this discovery could give them. Because if they are humanoid, we can do a hell of a lot more than what we're doing right now. They're in imminent danger, despite the laws that I've been able to initiate. It does happen. And, you know, education and intelligence, intelligent application of law is what we need.
Well, Robert, I have one question I would like to ask you.
Sure.
You mentioned Arkansas,
mm-hmm.
that there was creatures down in there. Is it possible, because this happened, I would say, somewhere around the middle of February.
Right.
Is it possible that these animals or whatever they are migrate from that area
to
Colorado?
Oh, Bugs, they're all over. They're here in Montana. They're in Florida. They're in Ohio. They're in Pennsylvania. They're in New York State, upstate New York. They're in Washington, Oregon. The only place I've never had a real report is in Pahrump, Nevada.
Say what?
But in any case, they're all over the place, and they do move quite a bit. They do have, unfortunately, predictable to some degree, movement patterns. But this is by virtue of weather and food availability. But they do have they move quite a bit, and what you have there are probably offshoots from the Washita Mountains and in that area, and also I must say in New Mexico, in the highlands of New Mexico, you also have them there, and in the Mogollon Rim of Arizona, they're there also.
Well, see, that's what I was wondering because if you take a map and you follow the Red River, you know,
mm-hmm.
it would lead from Arkansas to nearly to New Mexico.
Uh-huh.
And I was just wondering if this was a possibility that this was a route that these animals travel, and they go south in the winter and go north in the summer.
Hmm. Well, they have their own routes, but they don't necessarily have to go by virtue of the weather. They're perfectly adapted. Unlike you and I, they don't have to worry about the weather. When they're cold, in fact, the colder it gets, I think, in a lot of ways, the better off they are. The ones that I've encountered in Florida are much smaller and thinner and scrawnier not anywhere near as healthy as the ones that I've seen up in the northern states.
That's a good question. Did these animals appear to you, other than being dead, to be healthy specimens?
Oh, yes, very healthy. They were very muscular.
Sure.
I would say they were younger animals than older ones, because they just appeared that, you know, that they were younger. I hate to make this I don't know the word I'm looking for, but the equation to this to what I would say in a human factor, and this is the one thing that scared us, and I don't want anybody to take this wrong, but you have seen mentally retarded people, their facial features and everything. That's what we thought we had done shot with some mentally retarded people that was living in the wild.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very brutal facial features that are almost Neanderthalic, and a little bit more so, I think. I wish I could reach out and help you somehow. I really do.
Let me be very straight on a few things here. Number one, Bugs, you don't want your identity revealed, right?
No.
Okay. Number two, you don't want to go back to the spot yourself.
No. I'll take you within... I can take you up on a hill and show you where it's at within probably, I would say, maximum of a quarter to half a mile away.
Mm-hmm.
But there is something inside of me that just will not let me go back to that spot.
Yeah, I don't think I blame you. And that's where you gave up hunting, too.
Right.
All right. Listen, Bugs. Thank you, my friend, for coming back on here tonight.
Well, you're welcome, Art, and I appreciate it. And
so I will honor your wishes.
I would like to explain one reason why I'm doing this.
Yes, sure.
It is because of you and what you have done for all the people in this United States. You are the one person that brings forth the stuff that everybody else laughs at.
Mm.
And someday, when I'm gone, you'll get to laugh at them because you'll have the proof.
Thank you, Bugs.
All right. Good night, Art. Good night, Robert.
Good night, Bugs. Good luck to you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.